Now available on Tata Sky channel number 526.
Hello and welcome. You're watching Property Hotline with me, Kavita Krishnan, on India's first property channel, Magicbricks Now. Today we are answering all your legal queries that you have while buying, selling or investing in property. We have with us Nirav Jani. He's a senior associate at Hariani and Company. Nirav, welcome to the show.
Hi, thank you.
Tirumala Murali has called in with a question. Tirumala, go on, tell us what's your question.
Yeah, hello.
Yes, Tirumala, tell
hello.
Us.
Hello, can you... Yeah, you are able to hear me?
Yeah, loud and clear.
Yeah. I had rented a property in Tanjavur, which is in Tamil Nadu.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the tenant was for... he's been there for the last 20 years. The building is very old one. And 6 years back, we had asked him to vacate the house because we wanted to renovate the house. He had promised that he would do it. But one fine day, we received a court order telling that we had been harassing him and it showed that he didn't want to vacate the house. Now, it's been now 5 years, it's been now 3 years since he has not vacated. He doesn't, when he had sent the court notice, we had to go to the lawyer. And so, based on the lawyer's advice, we had appeared in the court and the summons was given to him. He did not receive the summon any time and he's been not there in the residence of my house. He has kept the house locked for many years. So it shows that he doesn't want to vacate the house and he wants to take away the house. The eviction order was also given. He did not receive the court order and later he asked him to reconsider and he is telling that he was not well. All these things. So we do not know how to go about this because it's now 3 years.
Right, 3 years you've taken him to court but he's not even showing up in court. That is your biggest problem. And you want to know how you can evict him. What can Tirumala do over here?
See, as I understand, if there's an eviction order that has already been passed, then that order needs to be executed. For which you'll have to take out proceedings wherein the court appointed commissioner will be appointed. And in the event tenant fails to vacate, then the court will use appropriate force, including police if required, and the eviction can be obtained. So if the order is in your favor, then you only need to follow the process for the purpose of executing that order.
So then you suggest Tirumala goes back to court and tells him that, you know, you all have passed the order, but he's obviously not accepting the order and there is nobody in that house and the house is locked.
Yes, so there is a process to execute court orders, which you will have to follow and the court will execute its own orders.
Okay, so Tirumala, go back to the court and ask the court to execute the orders. Tell them that the person in question is not around, the house is locked, he is not responding to the court order, and then the court will take the necessary steps. Okay, with that, let's take our next caller. Rakesh Sharma has called in. Rakesh, how can we help you?
Yeah, good evening. This is Rakesh Sharma. Actually, I want to ask about a stalled project where we have invested. This is a project in Zirakpur. We had more than 153 people had invested in this project of the builder. But later on in March 2012, the builder, without informing anybody, raised a loan for the completion of the project from Canara Bank.
Okay.
And Canara Bank, and later on the project got stalled because of shortage of funds. And Canara Bank... the builder also defaulted on Canara Bank's loan also. And Canara Bank in the month of October took symbolic possession of that project because the account had become NPA.
Okay. So now right. So has Canara Bank taken possession of the symbolic possession of the entire project or is a part of the project mortgaged to the bank? Do you have an idea?
The entire project has been taken over by Canara Bank. It has... it has taken symbolic possession. But later on, when we met Canara Bank officials, we got to know that the builder had already informed the Canara Bank that more than 153 flats had already been booked prior to March 2012, which I was also part of those 153 flats. and the Canara Bank and the builders did not inform us that the project is henceforth mortgaged with the Canara Bank. We on our own got together and filed a writ petition in DRT, Chandigarh, where for the time being the DRT has been pleased to give us an interim stay. We pleaded that we were never aware that this project has been mortgaged by the Canara Bank. Neither the Canara Bank nor the builder told us that the project is mortgaged with the Canara Bank. Now, what I want to ask is, can bank take possession of the flats of those buyers who had booked flats prior to March 2012 when the builder raised the loan? Second is, can the those flat buyers whom Canara Bank had given NOC in favor of other banks to avail loans for financing their flats of the builder, can their flats also be taken over by the Canara Bank? Thirdly, there are some buyers who had bought the flat and builder, neither the builder nor the Canara Bank notified in public that the project is mortgaged with Canara Bank. They were unaware, builder tried to dupe them, did not tell them, Madam, maybe it is quite clear that the builder...
Right. Rakesh, let me bring in Nirav over here. So Nirav, essentially this is a case where the flats were sold to the buyers and then the entire project was mortgaged to the bank and the builder has now defaulted on the loans. Bank has taken possession. In fact, it's turning out to be quite common. We know of something like this that's happened in the Mumbai market as well. What are the builders, the buyer's rights, I'm sorry, in this regard?
So, two things need to be noted here. In the event the buyers have a registered agreement in their favor prior to creation of any rights and mortgage in Fironi Bank, then they will be protected to that extent because they have a registered agreement in their favor. If they do not have a registered agreement in their favor and they only have a booking form or a letter of allotment, then their right will lie only against the builder for the recovery of money or for the flat. In the event any flat purchasers purchase subsequent to the mortgage and without taking an NOC, then again that person will not have a recourse against the bank because the bank is a secured creditor and it will take its charge prior to everybody. So in such a case, again, he will have his right against the developer and nothing against the bank. And as far as the NOCs and the other rights are concerned, you will have to minutely look at the document as to what are the rights that have been created and what are the consequences in the event of default.
So essentially what you're saying is that anybody, like in this project, since the flats were, he has sold flats prior to 2012. 2012 was when he raised, when the builder raised that loan from Canara Bank. So any flat that was sold and registered before 2012, those buyers still have rights over their flats. The others do not have any rights whatsoever.
Yes, because they are not registered agreements. They are only letters of allotment. So they will have their right only against the builder because no rights per se would have been created.
So when you say rights against the builder, now if these buyers do go to court against the builder, of course, I mean, they have to go to court against the builder is what you're saying.
So typically, if the bank enforces its mortgage, and it comes to a situation where the bank has to take possession, and including physical possession of these flats, then in that case, they will have to file a case against the builder seeking refund of the amount. Because the bank will take a symbolic possession under the Surfacey Act, and then it will also have to sell that flat out to recover its money. And their right will be first in line because they have a registered mortgage in their favor.
Right. So essentially, if you have a registered agreement before 2012, which was when the loan was taken by the developer, then you're safe. If not, then you need to go to court immediately against the developer to ensure that you get your right to that house. We have Miriam who's called in now. Miriam, tell us, what's your question?
Hello.
Yes, Miriam.
I bought two adjacent apartments about 3 years ago, but made only one combined sale deed. Now I would like to make two separate sale deeds. So please let me know what is the procedure.
Can she make two separate sale deeds for two apartments for which initially she had made only one sale deed?
Yeah. Unfortunately, she will only be able to file a declaration saying that there are two separate apartments because the agreements have already been signed. the anomaly will continue now as far as it's concerned. When the position comes for her to sell the flat, one of them, she will have to give a covenant for production of title documents, because originally for the first time, that is only one document, and that they will have to decide who's going to keep it. Okay. So as of now, where our question goes, she will not be able to do any document wherein she is going to be able to make two separate documents, because there is already a registered, or there is already a document, or one document for both the
flats. But she can sell it. What
she can
saying,
sell
she
separately.
Can sell it as two separate apartments, and when she sells it, then she has to make two separate sales deeds.
Yeah, so she can sell it to separate apartments separately to two separate individuals. But at that point in time, she'll have to give a covenant to produce this document, because this will only be one document. So then, and they will have to eventually decide who's going to keep the original of this particular document.
Can that create a problem? Can that create an issue for whoever's buying into that flat? Will that be a problem there?
No, if there's a proper covenant of production of title documents, then may not. But right. Generally, for flats, people are a little wary in such situations. This is more seen in case of a larger piece of land, when you have one document for a larger piece of land and then it gets subdivided subsequently, and you have one document as an original title document.
So, Miriam, you can essentially sell the flats to two separate buyers, but like Nirav said, you'll have to produce that covenant of production document, which means you need to get in touch with a lawyer before you sell that flat. We have Ravindra who's called in now. Ravindra, tell us, what's your question?
Sir, my question is, I have got a possession after redevelopment for my flat. But the builder is not made the agreement so far. I got a possession in 2009. And he's avoiding always.
Okay. Have you approached him? Has he given you anything in writing as to why he's avoiding the agreement?
No. He has given only the possession letter he signed. After that, he told me that he'll do the agreement. He'll do today, tomorrow, like that. He's just passing on the time.
And was there an agreement that you signed with him before the building went into redevelopment?
No. Nothing was signed as such, because he has given us directly after the collapse. So because he has done the building, then he gave us the flat.
Okay, means
it was, there was no demolition at all.
Right.
Just, he transferred me to that from old to new building.
Nirav, Ravindra has a very uncommon problem, I must say. The problem generally in redevelopment is that people don't get possession. Here he's got possession, he's not got an agreement. What can he do now?
So typically what he should do is he should draft out an agreement himself, annex it to a covering letter and send it to the builder saying that this is the agreement that we should sign in order to crystallize my legal rights on paper, as you have already given me the possession and I'm the owner of the flat. In the event he does not respond to or he does not sign, then his recourse is to go to the court.
So Ravindra, that's the answer. Draft an agreement, send it to the developer, ask him to sign it. If he refuses to sign it, go to court. Ritesh has written in through email. Now, Nirav, he wants to know if builders can register themselves in RERA for ongoing projects to get new consumers into confidence. Essentially, RERA does cover under construction projects as well, right?
Yes, so all the projects on the date of the Act coming into force which have not received completion certificate, they will have to, within a period of 3 months thereafter, register themselves under RERA.
Now, Nirav, just break this down for our viewers. A completion certificate is something that you get at the end of the project.
Yes.
This is essentially after you get the water and the electricity connections, am I right?
It's in as far as BMC is concerned, it's post-OC.
Post-OC.
Post-occupation certificate.
Every work that has to be done by the developer has been completed.
Yes.
Now, I'm also told that there are a lot of if you talk about Mumbai itself, there are a lot of buildings where people have moved in, as in they've got possession, people have started living there, have lived there for a couple of years, but they've not yet got the completion certificates from the developers. So these projects also would come under RERA?
If it is an ongoing project, so the word is ongoing, so I mean if the project is completed but the only remaining aspect is to obtain a completion certificate, then there is nothing for him to declare or nothing for him to do in RERA, because he's not doing any project. But yes, if there is a project that's ongoing or if there is potential in that project to have further development, then they will have to.
Right. So, ongoing projects, projects that are currently under construction, when RERA comes into force, that those are the projects where there is no completion certificate that has been given. These are the projects that will be covered by RERA.
Yes.
Right? To make it very clear to you, and also, let us tell you this, that RERA has been passed by the center, by the union government. However, states will have to enact their own regulators. They have to enact their, they have to, you know, come up with a list of rules. They'll have to come up with features, create an entire ecosystem, make the regulator, make an appellate tribunal, and only after that will RERA actually come into force in your state. And how long do you expect that to take?
They have been given 1 year to do that.
So they've been given 1 year. So that's one more year for the regulator to actually start work on ground. So you'll need to look out for that as well if you're planning to buy in an under construction project, because that is what I expect you mean by your question, Ritesh. We'll now take Rati Gabriel's question. Rati joins us on the phone line. Tell us what's your question.
We had brought a plot, five of us together, my mother and two brothers, me, my sister-in-law. All together we brought a plot. We want to register it, and they are asking for rupees 32,000. So I just wanted to know whether we can like gift it to one person, and that person pays that 32,000, and others again, if they want, they can re-gift it. Actually, how is it? Is it okay?
Rati, why would you want to do that?
To save that 32,000 which we had to pay.
Okay, you're saying that all of y'all have been asked to pay 32,000 rupees each to register that?
Individually, yeah.
So, Nirav, what can they do to save on that registration
but
cost?
But if you all have bought it jointly, then you all will be putting it in one document only.
No, we have not brought it jointly. We have brought it separately. But when we had to pay 32,000. So we thought we can gift it to one person, and then we can one person will pay that and re-gift.
No, Rati, tell us this. Do you have separate agreements for that plot of land, or is there just one agreement with all your names on it?
No, we have got separate agreement for that.
Which means you have to register it separately.
Agreement exactly what we pay, we have a this saying ki. It is all registered on your name. Names are registered. We have to officially go and register it on the government.
Right. So, Nirav, five or six different agreements over here. Is there any way they can register it as one single document?
If they bought it separately and they're separate individual properties, then to own and to show your separate entitlement to the property, you'll have to have your own document. So by putting it one person's name, virtually what I presume they're trying to do is one person takes all the properties and then he individually gifts it to them. But then again, gift will again be have to be registered and will attract registration fee.
Right. And also, Rati, remember this, that in the long run, if you register your property separately, you will continue to have right of ownership over that particular piece of property that you have bought. And in case you jointly try to register property through the method that you are doing, you might just end up losing that, you know, right to property. In case you all end up, contesting for right over that particular property, then this could actually backfire. So I guess, like Nirav said, you'd be better off paying the 32,000 and registering the property separately. Let's take Naresh's call next. Naresh has called in. Tell us what's your question.
Hello.
Yes, Naresh, tell us what's your question.
Yeah, actually, I had bought an office in 1996. Mm. And we had paid 40 lakhs. The office was worth 60 lakhs.
Okay.
So we paid 40 lakhs and then we went to the developer that we cannot pay much, 20 more lakhs. So please do something. Then he agreed, saying that, okay, fine, we will allot you a smaller office which is worth 40 lakhs. Or we'll give you that much amount of space that is worth 40 lakhs. Then when the building came to the completion, he didn't give anything. He wrote us a letter saying that your 20 lakhs are still pending and you have to pay that or else we'll forfeit your amount. We went to them and they said that still your 20 lakhs are left, so you have to pay. So we told him that it is not possible for us to pay right now. Please do something. Then he said, okay, fine, let me do something. If I come across an offer, I'll do it. Then he so wrote us a letter, a registry sending that we have forfeited your amount. He kept on giving us false promises and he was doing legal actions against us and he forfeited our amount.
Naresh, do you have any kind of agreement from the developer offering you a smaller office for the 40 lakhs you paid him?
No, the thing is, when we paid 40 lakhs, he gave us receipts of the building, okay? And then he sent us a registry saying he didn't, actually it was an oral agreement that we did and he said that, okay, fine, I will give you a smaller office for 40 lakhs.
So you have nothing in writing saying that you'll get a smaller office, right?
No, nothing at all.
Okay, no receipts also.
No, I have a receipt of the money that I have given to him. But the only problem is that in our country in 1996, you know, there were nothing called agreements and those procedures which are normal.
Right. Let me get Nirav in over here. Nirav, what can he do now?
In the event Naresh does not have any correspondence or any sort of written record to prove that the developer had agreed to give him a smaller office, then he goes back to his original position. And I believe he doesn't even have an agreement for the 40 lakhs that has been paid. So therefore, the developer's case will be that it's forfeited and his case will be that to seek a refund. Unfortunately, the developer has got the money with him. So he will have to go to court to seek his refund because he doesn't have an agreement in place.
But how strong a case does he have? Like he said, he just has receipts. He does
It's one person's word against the other because they don't have any agreement as to what happens in the event he defaults in payment of the further amount, whether the developer can forfeit it or not. So in the absence of any written agreement, it'll be left to the best judgment of the court as to who proves his case in a far better manner.
So that's the only thing that you can do. You can go to court and fight it out and try and gather as much evidence, to strengthen your case in the meanwhile. Now we're joined by Soumyajit on the phone. Soumyajit, tell us what's your question and try and make it quick because we have very little time left on the show.
I'm a lawyer also. Incidentally, what had happened, I purchased a property in Ghaziabad. And I paid the entire dues and according to the builder has given me the NOC and the position has been handed over to me. Now what had happened after the handing over the position, they're supposed to register in my name, but they have not done. And it appears that the builder's office as well as the site office, everything has been closed out. And the person is now absconded. It also appears there are some criminal cases which has been filed against the builder.
Okay.
But on a register, but nothing has been. But I could not. Now, the problem is that I could not register my property. In such event, what I have to do?
Right. He cannot. He has not registered his property, and the builder's office is shut down. What does he do now? Nirav, quick answer. We are completely out of time.
Soumyajit, as you are aware, I mean, you will have to approach the court, and in the event he does not come to court, you will get an ex parte order in your favor, and that will become your document of title.
So, Soumyajit, go to court, get an ex parte order in your favor if the developer doesn't show and claim rights over that property. With that, it's a wrap on this edition of Property Hotline. Nirav Jani, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
If you have any feedback or suggestions that you would like to share, any questions you want to ask, and like I keep telling you, it's not just legal queries or buy, sell and invest queries that we answer. We also answer queries regarding taxes and home finance. So do get in touch with us through email, Facebook, Twitter, our website www.mbnow.in or simply call us live on Property Hotline. Thank you very much for watching. Keep watching Magicbricks Now.
You can watch live TV on our website, mbnow.in. Find us on Facebook at facebook.com/magicbricksnow. And don't forget to click the like button. You can also follow us on Twitter at magicbricksnow. To stay updated with all our programming, hit the subscribe button on our YouTube channel by logging on to youtube.com/magicbricksnow.